Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents They Knew They Were Pilgrims, Plymouth Colony and the Contest for American Liberty by John G. Turner. Narrated by Bob Souer. Introduction. Americans learn about the Pilgrims when they are children. In elementary schools across the country, late November has been a time for pilgrim hats and Indian headdresses. Along the way, Americans absorb elements of the pilgrim myth: a ship, a compact, a rock, a winter of death and disease, a harvest, and a Thanksgiving turkey meal. It is a heartwarming story about two peoples feasting together instead of fighting each other. There is also an alternative, more dispiriting history, a story of betrayal and theft. The Pilgrims made a treaty and alliance with the Indians, then took their land and killed or enslaved those who resisted. Those native communities that survived found themselves reduced to small, impoverished enclaves. In this line of thought, the ongoing American adulation of the Mayflower passengers is offensive. Late November is a time for mourning, not a time for giving thanks. They Knew They Were Pilgrims includes aspects of the previous stories, but also introduces other narratives. This is a history of the peoples who lived in Plymouth Colony, alternatively New Plymouth, later known within Massachusetts as the Old Colony, from the English and Dutch events that led to its 1620 founding until its 1691 incorporation into a larger province of Massachusetts Bay. In its chapters, listeners will encounter famous men such as Governor William Bradford and Massasoit Assumequin, but also meet less familiar individuals. Awashonks, a female sachem who preserved a native community for two decades amid dispossession and war. William Vassal, who established a second church within a single town and contended for religious liberty before colonial and English courts. And James Cudworth, a Plymouth Colony magistrate who lost his position when he defended persecuted Quakers. In his own history, Bradford promised to proceed in a plain style with singular regard unto the simple truth in all things. Plymouth Colony's history, though, is not plain, singular, or simple. During the early years of the American Republic, ministers, politicians, and historians lionized the Pilgrims. Timothy Dwight, John Quincy Adams, and George Bancroft drew straight lines from the Mayflower Compact to the Declaration of Independence and the Constitutional Convention, making the Pilgrims the heroic progenitors of democracy and republicanism. Then, in the mid to late 19th century, Americans came to associate the Pilgrims with an annual observance of a late November Thanksgiving Day. The holiday further enhanced interest in the Mayflower passengers, now the most famous colonists in the history of what became the United States. Despite the ongoing popular appeal of the Pilgrims, academic historians have largely ignored Plymouth Colony. When the mid-20th century historian Perry Miller resuscitated an interest in New England Puritanism, he concentrated on the more numerous, literary, and wealthy settlers of Massachusetts Bay. Plymouth makes no appearance at all in Miller's magisterial New England Mind. Apparently, there were no old colony minds worth mentioning. In particular, Miller convinced generations of historians that the Pilgrim Church exerted no influence on the broader development of New England Congregationalism. For example, historian of Puritanism Theodore Dwight Bozeman dismissed Plymouth's congregation as pathetically unimportant. If Plymouth Colony didn't matter for the development of New England religion, it obviously carried little weight in terms of politics or commerce. Samuel Eliot Morrison, Perry Miller's colleague at Harvard, admired the Pilgrims and edited a popular edition of Bradford's history, but he conceded Plymouth's insignificance. By any quantitative standard, he wrote, Plymouth was one of the smallest, weakest, and least important of the English colonies. For the most part, therefore, historians set Plymouth aside once John Winthrop and his Puritan flotilla reached Massachusetts Bay. Boston is the city on a hill, Plymouth a moribund backwater. Besides their place within American mythology and genealogy, then, do the Pilgrims and their colony matter? The Mayflower passengers and the other English settlers of Plymouth Colony had genuine accomplishments. The separatists among the Mayflower passengers transplanted a church in which laymen elected their officers and exercised discipline over each other. When they formed a government and made laws, Pilgrim leaders could not envision, and would not have favored, democracy as later Americans would understand it. Nevertheless, they established a political framework with a significant degree of participation, and one that endured for nearly 70 years. Plymouth Colony also matters in a very different respect. A few months after their 1620 landing, the Pilgrims established a mutual defense treaty with Massasoit. While this alliance initially benefited both English settlers and Wampanoags, the Pilgrims took steps to establish themselves as the foremost military power in the region. By the time of Massasoit's 1660 death, Plymouth's magistrates treated and mistreated the Wampanoags as their subjects. Settlers acquired Wampanoag land through purchase, pressure, and swindle. Eventually, sachems in the western portion of New Plymouth chose armed resistance over further dispossession and humiliation. The resulting King Philip's War, 1675 to 1678, shattered native and English communities across New England. Still, the merit of unearthing and narrating New Plymouth's history does not hinge only on the colony's grand significance or lack thereof. Rather, they knew they were Pilgrims uses Plymouth Colony as a fresh lens for examining the contested meaning of liberty in early New England. The English settlers who came to New Plymouth over the span of its seven-decade history shared a fierce commitment to liberty, but they understood it in a variety of often contradictory ways. Prominent among these meanings were the many varieties of Christian liberty articulated by the colony's Protestant Christians. The majority of the Pilgrims were separatists, men and women who had entirely rejected the Church of England. They did so to reclaim what they understood as the liberty of the gospel, their freedom to form their own churches and choose their own officers. These Pilgrim separatists embarked for North America because they wanted to preserve their liberty to worship God in accordance with their understanding of the Bible. "They knew they were Pilgrims," wrote William Bradford. Even before John Bunyan further popularized the motif through The Pilgrim's Progress, many English Protestants understood their lives as spiritual pilgrimages, beset with temptations and afflictions, but with the promise of eventual glory. Plymouth Colony settlers disagreed among themselves, however, about the prescribed earthly course for this pilgrimage, in particular about what constituted the pure worship of God. Many settlers also favored liberty of conscience. But this was another slippery phrase. Liberty of conscience sometimes simply meant that religious dissenters could opt out of established forms of worship, but it also could imply a fuller toleration of religious pluralism. Throughout most of Plymouth Colony's 70-year history, magistrates did not force individuals to attend worship, join churches, or have their children baptized. In these significant respects, settlers enjoyed a certain amount of liberty of conscience. At the same time, dissenters did not possess the freedom to air their opinions or gather with like-minded men and women for their own religious exercises. Also, once Plymouth's government mandated that towns tax inhabitants to build congregational churches and pay congregational ministers, it did not exempt dissenters from these obligations. Quakers and some Baptists contended for a more complete religious toleration. They eventually gained the liberty to worship according to their own principles, but their struggle against church taxes continued long after New Plymouth's demise. Some of the Pilgrims suffered persecution for their religious beliefs and practices in England. Once in charge of their own colony, however, they persecuted others. Plymouth's leaders banished a number of dissenters, and they whipped, imprisoned, and fined scores of Quakers. As the historian Alexandra Walsham observes of 17th-century Europeans more generally, this apparent double standard was not rank hypocrisy. Like most of their contemporaries, Pilgrim leaders desired religious uniformity and understood Christian liberty as mandating very specific forms of worship, church government, and discipline. Until late in the 17th century, the main argument among European Christians was not whether there should be only one religious option, but what that option should be and how governments should penalize those who did not conform to it. Debates about liberty were as much about politics as religion. Building upon the ideals of the Mayflower Compact, Plymouth's settlers declared that, according to the free liberties of England, they would not suffer any law or tax to be imposed on them except by their own consent. They also regarded annual elections and the right to a jury trial as fundamental liberties. Both in New England and Old England, there was disagreement about who possessed these liberties and exactly what constituted consent, but there was a common vigilance against the arbitrary exercise of political power. Towns resisted when New Plymouth's general court ordered them to build meeting houses or levy church taxes, and settlers protested when a crown-appointed governor imposed taxes on them without their consent. Finally, there were English men and women who simply wanted the liberty to live as they pleased. These individuals wanted nothing to do with New England's churches or governments. If they criticized those institutions or in other ways made themselves conspicuous, they suffered reprisals. Especially on the margins of the colony, though, settlers found the space to follow their own principles and pursuits. When 17th-century Englishmen felt deprived of their liberties, they complained that they were being made slaves. It was a powerful argument because the English were well acquainted with slavery and servitude. As was the case in other colonies, Plymouth's settlers reduced people to various forms of bondage. Many English and some Irish men, women, and children came to the colony as indentured servants, and courts sometimes sentenced offenders to periods of servitude. Even before the Pilgrims anchored off Cape Cod, moreover, Europeans had captured and enslaved dozens of native people in the region. One of those victims, Tisquantum, or Squanto, was from the site of the Pilgrim settlement. While Plymouth's early leaders criticized the men who had mistreated Squanto, their descendants enslaved large numbers of native men, women, and children, sometimes for a set number of years, but in many cases for life. Hundreds of native slaves were exported, ending up in the Caribbean or across the Atlantic Ocean. By this time, Plymouth's English households also owned a small but significant number of African slaves. As in the rest of the transatlantic English world, liberty and bondage developed in tandem. Over the course of the 17th century, New Plymouth's English settlers, and at times the native peoples and African Americans within its bounds, came to speak shared languages of liberty, but conflicts about the nature and extent of those liberties remained unresolved. They still are. Present-day Americans cherish liberty but disagree vehemently about its meaning. One person's religious liberty is, from another vantage point, a license to discriminate, and Americans have bitter arguments about who is entitled to the rights enshrined in the founding documents of the United States. 4 centuries after the Mayflower, the history of the Pilgrims and Plymouth Colony points us back to earlier chapters in this contest for liberty. Chapter 1. The Lord's Free People. Lord, have mercy upon us. Kyrie eleison. Since the early centuries of Christianity, worshippers have spoken and sung these Greek words in their liturgies. Familiar from their repetition in the Church of England's Book of Common Prayer, the words assumed a very different meaning when Robert Cushman tacked them on a church door. Cushman was baptized in 1578 in the Kentish village of Rovenden, about 30 miles southwest of Canterbury. Cushman's father was a farmer who left each of his sons £10 upon his 1586 death. His mother remarried the next year, buried her second husband 2 years later, and married for the third time in 1593. When he came of age, Cushman moved to Canterbury. In 1597, he became an apprentice to a grocer named George Masters. For several centuries, grocers had belonged to guilds, which protected their right to sell spices, confections, and sometimes medicines and tobacco. Cushman's inheritance provided the premium that persuaded Masters to engage him. In Canterbury, Masters had the exclusive right to make and sell tallow candles. "It is a nauseous, greasy business," cautioned a mid-18th-century manual on apprenticeships. Still, at least in Canterbury, completing an apprenticeship meant an opportunity to become a freeman, someone with the right to practice a trade and participate in a community's civic life. Cushman could look forward to a future as a respectable tradesman. Outside of Cushman's christening, the deaths of his parents, his mother died in 1601, and the start of his apprenticeship, nothing is known about Cushman's life to this point. Men like Cushman usually appear in the historical record only if they got into trouble. Cushman did so in the fall of 1603, when he and several other young men wrote and posted libels on the doors of Canterbury churches. Their message was simple: "Lord, have mercy upon us." The implication was that God needed to save his people from a corrupt church. A few years later, Cushman concluded that the Church of England was beyond rescue. The church door libels were the first step that took Cushman to the Dutch Republic and then to Plymouth Colony. Robert Cushman wasn't alone. In 1620, most of the adult passengers on the Mayflower, at least those who were not servants, were separatists, men and women who had rejected the Church of England. Their stories began with small acts of Puritan protest that eventually led them out of church and country. Almost a century before the Mayflower, the English Reformation had begun with a messy double divorce, that of a king from his wife and of a church from Rome. King Henry VIII wanted his marriage to Catherine of Aragon annulled. She had failed to bear him a son, and he was in love with another woman. Pope Clement VII rebuffed the king's request. With the support of English courts and lawmakers, Henry cast off Catherine and married Anne Boleyn. In 1534, Parliament declared Henry the only supreme head on earth of the Church of England. The long reign of Elizabeth, who became queen in 1558 after the death of her Catholic half-sister Mary, gradually made England a resolutely Protestant country. At the same time, there were large numbers of Protestants unsatisfied with the extent of reform. With more than a hint of self-righteousness, these individuals often referred to themselves as the godly. Their opponents derided them as precisians or Puritans. The hotter sort of Protestants are called Puritans, explained Percival Wilburn, himself a rather fiery minister. While Puritans were hot about many different things, most rejected vestments, the robe, white linen surplice, and other priestly garments, the sign of the cross, and saints' days. They associated such practices with the Catholic Church and contended that the Bible did not authorize them. Puritans were leery of prayer books altogether, believing that ministers should instead preach and pray according to their learning and the promptings of God's Spirit. Many Puritans, finally, favored what became known as Presbyterianism. They wanted to replace England's bishops and church courts with an ecclesiastical government more akin to that of Geneva or Scotland, in which consistories and synods, comprised of ministers and elders, exercised discipline. Around the turn of the 17th century, Puritan became a common epithet in England. A Puritan, went one of many insults, is such a one as loves God with all his soul but hates his neighbor with all his heart. Neighbors who wanted to enjoy church fairs or a Sunday afternoon at a tavern resented godly attempts to do away with traditional forms of merriment. Playwrights such as Ben Jonson mercilessly skewered Puritans as both busybodies and hypocrites. On the page and on the stage, Puritans said grace until their food was ice cold, indulged until they became fat and flatulent, and used their conventicles as cover for orgies. Despite their differences, nearly all Protestants remained loyal to a single national church to which all men and women belonged and whose ministers baptized all children. Puritans insisted that they had no intention of abandoning the church that had nurtured their own faith. Even if they found certain ceremonies and practices abhorrent, even as they formed their own networks of preachers and clandestine gatherings, most of the godly waited and worked for the further reformation of England's church. A small number of Puritans, however, gave up. If other zealous reformers were the hotter sort of Protestant, separatists were the hottest. They wanted to tear down the Church of England and start from scratch, and they would not wait. Their Christian liberty hinged on their willingness to make an immediate separation. Rooted in the writings of the Apostle Paul, the idea of liberty was central to the thought of the Protestant reformers. For Paul, Christians were freed from sin, Satan, and death not through obedience to the law, but by their faith in God's gracious gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. When certain church leaders insisted that non-Jewish men who converted to Christianity be circumcised, Paul objected. "Stand fast, therefore," he wrote, "in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free." Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. In a very different context, Martin Luther argued that a Christian is a perfectly free lord of all, subject to none. Luther maintained that a Christian needed no works to make him righteous and save him. Christians could not earn their salvation through scrupulous fidelity to the law or any other ecclesiastical requirements. It was God's gift received through faith. John Calvin fully agreed with his Wittenberg counterpart that Christian freedom was a thing of prime necessity, a foundation of the Protestant insistence that God justified human beings on the basis of their faith in Christ. For Luther and Calvin, as for Paul, Christian liberty was not an individual freedom to do what one wished. Rather, liberty undergirded the cohesion of the community. "Use not your liberty as an occasion unto the flesh," Paul warned, "but by love serve one another," Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Luther emphasized that Christians were freed precisely so that they could follow the law that had previously condemned them. "A Christian," he wrote, "is a perfectly dutiful servant of all, subject to all." Freedom and subjection went hand in hand. Nor was Christian liberty the license to follow one's personal convictions when it came to religious belief and practice. Instead, the conscience should remain, in Luther's words, captive to the Word of God. Formerly bound to Satan, individuals whom God had liberated were now bound to Christ and to the teachings of their church. As the historian Stephen Osment explains, Protestants had only the right to dissent from Rome and to agree with Wittenberg or with Geneva if they followed Calvin. All Puritans contended that the work of liberating England's church from the yoke of Antichrist remained very incomplete. While English separatists echoed other Puritans on most matters of doctrine and ceremony, they articulated some distinctive ideas about Christian liberty and they advanced them with urgency. For separatists, the idea of an inclusive national church was a scandal. Bishops and monarchs had herded the wicked and the righteous alike into an impure institution. Separatists taught that church membership should be a voluntary act by which Christians covenanted with each other to follow the dictates of the Bible. Furthermore, once they formed their own congregations, Christians possessed the freedom to elect their own officers and to exercise church discipline. Without these liberties, Christians remained in bondage, whether to monarchs, magistrates, bishops, or synods. The Pilgrims would take this particular version of Christian liberty to New England. Separatists had advanced these arguments for decades and had little to show for it except a stable of martyrs. In or around 1581, the ministers Robert Brown and Robert Harrison concluded that the Church of England was beyond Reformation and formed their own independent and illegal congregation in Norwich. While Brown took pains to stress that he fully supported the Queen's civil power, he denied that she or any other political leaders held authority over the Church. "To compel religion," Brown insisted, "to plant churches by power and to force a submission to ecclesiastical government by laws and penalties belongeth not to them. Christ was the church's only king and head." As far as the queen and her bishops were concerned, this was a simple case of sedition. Brown and Harrison wisely moved with their followers to Middelburg in the Netherlands, but before their emigration, Brown had preached to groups of like-minded men and women in the Suffolk market town of Bury St. Edmunds. On the basis of a June 1583 royal proclamation, the authorities burned books written by Brown and Harrison and hanged two Bury men, a tailor and a shoemaker, who defended the condemned writings. Although Brown later returned to England and its national church, English separatists became known as Brownists. A few years later, the authorities raided a separatist congregation in London and arrested 21 men and women. More than a dozen separatist prisoners died in jail, but the ministers John Greenwood and Henry Barrow lived long enough to write lengthy defenses of their principles. For Greenwood and Barrow, the Bible identified the true church as the city, house, temple, and mountain of the eternal God. It was an enclosed vineyard or garden, an orchard of pomegranates, the bride of Christ, the society with which God covenanted to give His peace, love, salvation, presence, power, and protection. A properly organized congregation was something ravishing for Christians to behold. There was a spiritual fire at the heart of separatism, coupled with a belief that men and women could find assurance of their salvation within true churches. Like other separatists before them, Barrow and Greenwood taught that godly men and women should withdraw from England's false, anti-Christian church and form their own congregations in which they had the right to govern themselves. Christ's apostles had established churches based on this principle, but the people had neglected their duty and gave up their Christian liberty, first to groups of elders and then to bishops. "Christ hath given full power and liberty to all and every one of his servants," insisted Barrow. The laity should not, indeed lawfully could not, surrender that liberty to anyone. The admission of members, the election of officers, and the exercise of discipline rested with the congregation as a whole, or at least with its adult male members. In April 1593, authorities hanged Barrow and Greenwood, convicted for publishing seditious writings. 2 days after Barrow and Greenwood went to the gallows, Parliament passed a statute against attendance at any unlawful assemblies, conventicles, or meetings under color or pretense of any exercise of religion, contrary to Her Majesty's said laws and statutes. The penalty was imprisonment until offenders shall conform and yield themselves to come to some church, chapel, or usual place of common prayer and hear divine service. Obstinate nonconformists risked banishment. While the law could apply to a variety of dissidents, its framers intended to use it to stamp out Brownism. Under the leadership of new pastor Francis Johnson, the remainder of the London separatist congregation took refuge in Amsterdam. After other groups of English separatists came to the city, members of Johnson's congregation referred to themselves as the Ancient Church to distinguish themselves from more recent arrivals. Puritans were a much lampooned minority in late Elizabethan England, but they were a large minority with majority aspirations. By contrast, separatists were a tiny remnant, despised by conformists and Puritans alike. As far as many church and government officials were concerned, separatists sought not liberty but license, a throwing off of all restraints. Even radical Puritans were unstinting in their criticism of those who chose to leave the church, partly because antagonistic bishops tarred Puritans with the brush of Brownism, and partly because separatists accused everyone else of being in bed with Antichrist. For Catholics, separatists were the predictable fruit of Protestant schism. No one liked them. "I had as lief, rather, be a Brownist as a politician," quips Sir Andrew in Shakespeare's Twelfth Night. Nonetheless, fierce persecution and nearly universal condemnation could never quite extinguish separatism. There was, after all, a thin line between the more radical expressions of Puritanism and outright separatism. Those who preached against the corruption of the Church of England almost inevitably convinced a few in their midst, and sometimes themselves, that they had no choice but to separate from it. In March 1603, Queen Elizabeth died after reigning for nearly half a century. When James VI of Scotland assumed England's throne, Puritans hurried to recruit the new king to the cause of further reformation. James, who understood his kingdoms as bastions of Reformed Protestantism, told church leaders to improve the quality of parish preaching, and he authorized what became the most influential English translation of the Bible. At the same time, the king was entirely unsympathetic to Puritanism because he associated both it and Scottish Presbyterianism with limits on royal prerogatives. Like his predecessors, James placed a supreme value on his own supremacy. James invited several Puritan ministers, moderate reformers, not radicals, to Hampton Court and promptly dismissed most of their concerns as both petty and seditious. The king bristled at any proposals that would weaken the authority of bishops, which James connected to his own power. "No bishop, no king," he maintained. At the end of the conference's second day, the exasperated monarch had heard enough. "If this be all they have to say," he warned, "I shall make them conform themselves, or I will harry them out of the land, or else do worse." James was tickled with his performance. "I have peppered them soundly," he wrote a member of his privy council. Those who refused the airy sign of the cross after baptism, the king added, should no longer have their purses stuffed. Scores of ministers soon had lighter purses. In the spring of 1604, Richard Bancroft, the Bishop of London, prepared a new set of canons or church laws. Ministers would have to subscribe to declare their heartfelt acceptance of England's ecclesiastical government and ceremonies. The canons required them to affirm the king's supreme spiritual authority, the Book of Common Prayer, the sign of the cross, and the surplice. A sizable faction of the House of Commons understood Bancroft's canons as one of several royal affronts to parliamentary liberties. While disclaiming any sort of Puritan or Brownist spirit, a parliamentary committee denied the king's absolute power to make laws concerning the Church of England. James ratified the new canons anyway. Bancroft became Archbishop of Canterbury. ministers who refused to subscribe lost their positions, and the ecclesiastical campaign nudged a few radical Puritans right out of the church. Pockets of separatism reemerged. One of those pockets was in Canterbury. Ecclesiastical officials regarded the church door libels as a serious offense and sought advice from Lambeth Palace. A letter signed by Richard Bancroft instructed them to find the lewd, wicked, seditious persons, the makers, publishers, and dealers of the libels. The Court of the High Commission should imprison those responsible. If they refuse to provide testimony under oath, the commissioners should jail them until their tongues loosened. Robert Cushman, the apprentice grocer, talked, though he avoided saying a great deal. His master's son said more. Peter Masters testified that he had seen Cushman write one of the libels and that Cushman had given him several of them. He, Peter, had then given them to someone else to be put on the church doors. George Masters told the court that he regarded Cushman as a lewd fellow for getting his son involved. The court confined Cushman in the city's Westgate prison for a night. George Masters paid a fine of £20. At the same time, the church wardens of St. Andrew's Parish in Canterbury cited Cushman and another servant named Thomas Hunt for refusing to come to services. They claimed that they stayed away because they could not be edified in their church. Presumably, their parish minister did not preach sermons, or at least he did not meet their standards. Cushman refused repeated summons from the Archdeaconry Court, which then excommunicated him in January 1604. He received absolution but did not perform the required public penance and was excommunicated again later that year. In June 1605, he again asked for and received absolution. He still refused to publicly acknowledge his guilt, and the court eventually dismissed the matter. Cushman had received a large portion of mercy. His punishments had been light, and while George Masters must not have been pleased about the £20 fine, the affair did not interrupt Cushman's apprenticeship. He became a freeman in 1605. Cushman then married Sarah Reeder, a sister of two of his fellow libelers. The next year, the couple had their first child baptized in their parish church. Despite their discontents with the Church of England, the Cushmans had not yet broken from it. They grudgingly conformed. Robert Cushman soon put his respectable future in doubt once more, this time through his association with a theologically adventurous weaver named Gilbert Gore. In 1606, Canterbury church officials accused Gore of heresy. According to the records of the case, Gore denied the true and comfortable article of justification by faith in Christ Jesus, suggesting that a true and lively faith doth help no more in the justifying of elect sinners than hope, love, and obedience do. Gore's accusers charged that the weaver set up a false Christ which should be a justifier of unbelievers while they are unbelievers. Under considerable pressure, Gore confessed and recanted. Why did Gilbert Gore take issue with justification by faith, a core tenet of Protestantism? Gore wanted to emphasize that humans in no way earned their salvation. Whether Lutheran or Reformed, Protestant theologians shared this concern and described faith itself as God's gracious gift. The condition of man after the fall of Adam is such, the Church of England's 39 Articles maintained, that he cannot turn and prepare himself by his own natural strength and good works to faith. Gore was unusual, though, in fully severing faith from justification. For most Protestant theologians, faith was something fundamentally different than hope, love, and obedience. Faith was the instrument by which God saved his elect. Gore disagreed. He contended that God saved the elect purely on the basis of Christ's righteousness, which God imputed to those he had elected to save. In the decades ahead, a number of radical Protestants, often termed antinomians by historians, espoused views similar to those of Gilbert Gore. For example, in 1631, authorities in Ipswich accused several men of teaching that all the elect were justified and made the sons of God by the work of Christ before they have any faith to believe it. According to historian David Como, the notion was common currency among London antinomians. Church officials reacted sharply against such teachings, believing that they took away any incentive for men and women to inculcate faith and righteousness. Whether they were hot or only warm Protestants, English ministers understood their task as convicting men and women of their sinfulness, thus laying the groundwork for them to come to faith in Christ's gracious sacrifice on their behalf. What Gore taught threatened this entire system. Gore caused further alarm because he won others to his point of view in Canterbury and surrounding villages. His circle included a shoemaker, a blacksmith, a mercer, a hemp dresser, a tailor, several women, and Robert Cushman, who was identified to church officials by his new brother-in-law, Thomas Reeder. Several of those sympathetic to Gore had been involved in the 1603 libels case. Gore, meanwhile, promised to confess his errors in church, but when the minister began to read the liturgy, he turned his back in the most contemptuous manner and went out of the church. At one point, Gore fled Canterbury, then returned. He was excommunicated in 1607. Thomas Wilson, rector of Canterbury's St. George the Martyr Church, led the ecclesiastical response against Gore. Wilson was not an anti-Puritan like Richard Bancroft. Cushman later described him as a lover of goodness and good men, but Wilson did not count Gore among the latter. According to Cushman's account, Wilson caused Gore to be imprisoned for a year, threatened to burn him at the stake, and finally banished him from the city, and all for a trivial controversy. Wilson did not consider the matter trivial. In fact, he wrote a long dialogue on the subject of justification in which one character, Philautus, meaning a lover of himself, from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2, articulates Gilbert Gore's alleged heresy. For Wilson, Gore was among those libertines and carnal gospelers which turn the grace of God into wantonness and think they may sin more freely the more grace doth abound. In other words, the weaver's doctrines encourage licentiousness. Robert and Sarah Cushman soon left both Canterbury and the Church of England. It is unclear exactly what pushed them from discontent into outright separatism, but it seems that Wilson's treatment of Gilbert Gore contributed to the decision. Cushman became convinced that it is a sequestration and not a reformation that will heal us, help us, and give us a right church estate for to join unto. Unable to openly pursue that sequestration in England, the Cushmans went to Holland. Other men and women from Kent followed a similar path. Around the year 1600, a Canterbury tailor named James Chilton moved his rapidly growing family to the port town of Sandwich. 9 years later, Mrs. Chilton, forename unknown, and several other Sandwich residents attended the private non-church burial of a child. Church officials stated that the child was strongly suspected not to have died an ordinary death, but it is most likely that Mrs. Chilton and the others simply objected to Church of England burial customs. Many Puritans criticized the way that the Church of England conducted baptisms, marriages, and burials. They objected to the sign of the cross at baptisms, the use of rings at weddings, and the heathenish pomp and customs that accompanied burials. The separatist Henry Barrow did not think burials should involve clergy or any religious ceremony at all. There should be no pulpit orations or the placing of linen crosses on the corpse, no earth-to-earth, ashes-to-ashes words that came from the Book of Common Prayer rather than from the Bible. Church burials, Barrow alleged, were unheard of until popery began. Likewise, the Sandwich dissenters denounced church burials as popish ceremonies. Some Puritan ministers agreed and omitted liturgy and other rituals from burials, but very few of even the most radical lay Puritans would go so far as to bury corpses on their own. Church officials severely punished those who did so. Mrs. Chilton was excommunicated in June 1609. Moses Fletcher was also excommunicated for attending the private burial. Fletcher was a poor man whom the church and town helped in several ways. The church gave the Fletcher family relief money and made him a sexton. The town appointed him its beadle of vagrants. Despite the assistance, Fletcher rejected the church. He must have been quickly absolved because he was excommunicated again a few months later, this time for burying his own daughter privately during sermon time. Shortly thereafter, Fletcher was excommunicated for a third and final time. By the end of the decade, there were an estimated 30 separatists in Sandwich under the leadership of professed Brownist Richard Masterson. In Sandwich, Canterbury, and other pockets of Kent, women and men refused to attend parish services. Some left their children unbaptized. A few would not marry or bury as church and state required. Moreover, there were individuals in Kent who, like Gilbert Gore and Robert Cushman, dabbled in ideas the authorities deemed heretical. Especially in coastal ports such as Sandwich, it was easy for religious dissidents to move back and forth between England and the Low Countries. The Fletchers, the Chilterns, and Richard Masterson all moved to Leiden, joined by families from other parts of England. Joan Ashmore was a young servant to a young gentleman. She worked as a housekeeper at Broxtow Hall, the home of Thomas Helwys. Edmund Helwys, Thomas's father, was a minority member of the Nottinghamshire gentry. He owned some land on which the family and its tenants raised crops and sheep, and he obtained a lease for Broxtow Hall. When Edmund Helwys died in 1590, Thomas inherited the bulk of the estate, including the lease to Broxtow. The younger Helwys trained as a lawyer at Gray's Inn in London, then returned home. From this point forward, Thomas Helwys lurched from one controversy to another. In 1593, Helwys agreed to sell his interest in Broxtow Hall and at least some of his farmland to Robert Beresford and Ralph Waddington. According to Beresford, the deal included his sheep and crops as well. The sale soon ran aground. Beresford alleged that Helwys had overstated the number of years remaining on his lease, that some of the land actually belonged to the parish, and that Helwys refused to honor the agreement regarding the sheep and crops. Beresford and Waddington sued. They had given Helwys an advance payment and had sold other properties in order to have the funds on hand to complete the purchase. Beresford made additional allegations that raised eyebrows. He asserted that Helwys had deeded his property to his housekeeper, Joan Ashmore, whose evil counsel and persuasions seduced the young gentleman. Whether Helwys was duped or duplicitous or both, Beresford amended his suit to include Joan Ashmore as well. The resolution of the case is unknown. At roughly the same time, Thomas Helwys faced a complaint from his own sister. Edmund Helwys had left his daughter Anne her mother's jewels and clothes, a horse, a treasured songbook, some furniture, and his best cheese. The bequest amounted to more than £60. Anne Helwys, now Anne Green, asserted that her brother had refused to either give her the items or pay her for them. Perhaps he and Joan had eaten the cheese. Regardless of whether he had conspired with her to shield his property, Thomas Helwys decided that he wanted Joan Ashmore as more than his housekeeper. In May 1596, church wardens reported the couple on suspicion of fornication. The evidence was obvious. Joan was pregnant. She gave birth to a son in September. The truth was rather less scandalous than the accusation suggested. Thomas and Joan had married in the parish church of Bilborough. Why, then, were they accused of fornication? The most likely explanation relates to the date of their wedding. The Church of England, like the pre-Reformation Church, forbade marriage at certain times of the year. 144 days were off-limits, to be precise. Thomas and Joan Helwys married during Advent on December 3rd. Advent marriage doth deny, reminded a popular verse, but Hilary, January 13th, gives thee liberty. It was not that one could not wed during Advent, one could, but one needed to purchase a license from one's bishop. Many Puritans objected to the marriage date restrictions and regarded the sale of licenses as ecclesiastical extortion. Because the Helwyses chose not to be extorted, ecclesiastical busybodies harassed them for years. In 1598, the church wardens presented them again, this time for living together as man and wife who are not known to be married. 15 years later, church officials were still searching for their marriage license. By that point, Thomas and Joan Helwys had long since left the Church of England. In the village of Scrooby, only 40 miles to the north of Broxtow Hall, a group of men and women engaged in other types of Puritan nonconformity. Their leader was William Brewster, who lived in a manor house owned by the Archbishop of York. Brewster had inherited his father's position as postmaster and with it his residence in the Archbishop's house. The Great North Road, carrying mail and travelers between London and Scotland, intersected Scrooby and ran right by the manor house. Not content to watch the world pass through Scrooby, Brewster went out into it. After studying for a year or so at Cambridge, he became secretary to William Davison, sent by the Crown to the Low Countries to negotiate English support for the Dutch Protestant fight against Spanish Catholic rule. Brewster accompanied Davison to cities such as The Hague, Flushing, and Leiden. When Davison returned from abroad, he joined the Privy Council and played a role in the transmission of the warrant that ordered the death of Mary, Queen of Scots. Elizabeth wanted to avoid responsibility for her cousin's execution and settled on Davison as a scapegoat. He escaped serious punishment, but his career was over. Brewster came back to Scrooby with a great deal of knowledge about everything from foreign relations to court intrigues. Once home, though, Brewster settled down. He married. William and Mary Brewster named their children Patience, Fear, Love, and Wrestling. The names advertised the family's Puritan piety. In 1598, the Brewsters, along with a dozen or so other adults, were reported by their parish churchwarden for resorting to other churches in service and sermon time. Brewster defended himself before the archdeacon's court by saying that Scrooby shared a preacher with another parish, which he visited on alternate Sundays. It was a polite way of excusing the offense. In all likelihood, Brewster traveled more widely to listen to godly preaching. Brewster also was accused of repeating sermons publicly in the Scrooby Church without authority. In Canterbury, Robert Cushman was excommunicated after suggesting that he could not receive edification in his own parish, but the Scrooby dissidents avoided severe punishment. Brewster continued to live in the Archbishop's manor house. Gadding about to hear sermons was a characteristically Puritan habit, but it was not an especially serious act of nonconformity. The formation of new separatist congregations occurred when several deposed ministers intersected with these lay dissenters. John Smith studied at Cambridge, was ordained as a minister, and then held a fellowship at Christ's College until his 1598 marriage. Thereafter, Smith gained employment in Lincoln as a lecturer, a sort of preacher at large for the city. Smith was contentious, however, and he lost his position for what his opponents described vaguely as enormous irregular doctrine and undue teaching of matters of religion. Several years later, Smith published a tract in which he expressed wariness about the use of set prayers in worship. After his dismissal in Lincoln, Smith returned to his native Nottinghamshire village of Sturton-le-Steeple and preached irregularly there and elsewhere. A church warden in the nearby village of North Clifton described him in July 1603 as a painful, painstaking preacher of God's word, perhaps too painful. With an eye to Smith's prior indiscretions, John Whitgift, Archbishop of Canterbury, revoked his preaching license. Smith moved to Gainsborough, across the River Trent in Lincolnshire. The silenced minister felt the need to dispel rumors of Brownism. "I am far from the opinion of them which separate from our church," he wrote in a 1605 tract. Not that far, it turned out. John Robinson was also from Sturton-le-Steeple. From 1598 until 1604, he was a fellow at Cambridge's Corpus Christi College, and he preached in Norwich, including at St. Giles's Hospital. In 1604, Robinson married Bridget White. Although details on this period of Robinson's life are sparse, it seems that his Puritan leanings prevented him from obtaining a parish. Like John Smith, Robinson moved back to Nottinghamshire. As a shepherd without a flock, the restive minister stirred up trouble. That June, 17 men and women were reported for skipping their own parish services to hear Robinson preach at Sturton. In 1605, as church authorities increased pressure on Puritan ministers to conform, two other Nottinghamshire ministers lost their positions. Richard Clifton, who had refused to wear the surplice for around 15 years, was deposed from his position at Babworth after a hearing before the Archbishop of York, Matthew Hutton. That same month, Richard Bernard was suspended as vicar at nearby Worksop. In 1606, Bernard, Smith, and Thomas Helwys, and possibly John Robinson, traveled to the Coventry house of Isabel Bowes, a wealthy patroness of Puritanism. Others who came to the conference included the Puritan luminaries John Dodd and Arthur Hildersham. Those in attendance discussed how they should respond to the fact that King James had not reformed the church in accordance with their ideals. Was the Church of England still a true church? If not, should Christians leave it and form their own churches? Most of those in attendance rejected separation, which they believed would encourage their ecclesiastical opponents and give comfort to Catholics. Bernard, however, was done with moderation and patience. He gathered around 100 women and men from Worksop and surrounding parishes. They covenanted with each other and celebrated the Lord's Supper. According to John Robinson, Bernard and his followers promised to live righteously and to keep away from wicked or dumb, non-preaching ministers. Smith vacillated. He later wrote that he doubted 9 months whether to embrace the separation. Perhaps because of his inner turmoil, Smith became gravely ill. During his sickness, he stayed with Thomas and Joan Helwys, who nursed him back to health at their own expense. By then, Smith was ready to separate, as were the Helwyses. At this time, William Bradford was a young man living in Austerfield, a few miles north of Scrooby. Bradford's parents had died when he was a child. From the age of around 7, he lived with two of his uncles. The Bradfords were farmers. William probably had little formal schooling, but he was precocious and keenly interested in religious matters from an early age. Richard Clifton befriended the orphan, and as Bradford approached adulthood, he met with Brewster and other dissidents at Scrooby. In his history, Bradford wrote that, "As the Lord's free people, the separatists joined themselves by a covenant of the Lord into a church estate. They promised that they would walk in all God's ways, made known or to be made known unto them, whatsoever it should cost them. In this covenant, church members declared themselves both free and bound, free from ecclesiastical tyranny and human corruptions of true worship, bound to each other. With this step, they recovered their Christian liberty." The separatists formed two distinct bodies or churches, partly because of the 10 miles between Scrooby and Gainsborough. Smith led the Gainsborough group. Clifton led those who met with William Brewster at the Scrooby Manor House. Thus, the Scrooby separatists used a residence owned by the Archbishop of York to plot the Church of England's demise. Robinson continued to itinerate without a license, visiting parish churches and private homes at the invitation of like-minded ministers and laypeople. As the Scrooby and Gainsborough separatists worked to attract others to their principles, the authorities took notice. Toby Matthew, who became Archbishop of York in April 1606, was sympathetic to Puritan nonconformists, but not to separatists. Matthew convinced Richard Bernard to repent of separatism and restored him to his position at Worksop. Soon after he moved back into the vicarage, Bernard wrote The Separatists' Schism, a sharp attack on his former friends. A disgusted John Smith responded that Bernard was as changeable as the moon. Smith and Robinson considered Bernard an apostate, akin to Robert Brown. In September 1607, Matthew stopped in the village of Bawtry between Brewster's Scrooby and Bradford's Austerfield and preached a sermon contra Brownists. The Brownists in question apparently took this as a signal to leave. They would follow the example of other religious dissidents and go to the Low Countries where, as Bradford put it, they heard was freedom of religion for all men. One sizable group went to the Lincolnshire town of Boston on the River Witham, where they planned to board a ship that would take them into exile. It was illegal to leave the country without permission, even if enforcement was often loose. While many individuals moved back and forth between England and Holland, the flight of a large number of people was risky. In this case, the shipmaster betrayed them. Customs officers seized their belongings, and the authorities imprisoned a number of the men, including William Brewster. Also, officials charged 15 men, including Brewster, Clifton, Gervase Neville, and Thomas Helwys, with avoiding parish services and attending unlawful assemblies and conventicles. The charges alleged that the men were malicious and in contempt of the king. Still, the hand of the law was light. Bradford recalled that the magistrates used them courteously and showed them what favor they could. Bradford's assertion that he and his fellow separatists left England because they were hunted and persecuted on every side and watched night and day is an exaggeration. Unlike the separatists inspired by Robert Brown, John Greenwood, and Henry Barrow, the Scrooby and Gainsborough separatists did not suffer severe persecution. Archbishop Matthew did not imprison Robinson, Smith, or Clifton. Robinson was still preaching in churches as late as March 1608. Still, the screws slowly tightened. 2 months after his arrest in Boston, Gervase Neville, a Nottinghamshire gentleman, was brought before the Archbishop's High Commission. The court required individuals to swear an ex officio oath, agreeing to answer any questions, even if those answers amounted to self-incrimination. Moreover, the court was not obliged to inform individuals what crimes they were suspected of having committed. The separatist Henry Barrow had denounced the Court of High Commission as the very throne of the beast, utterly commingling, confounding, and subverting the whole liberty of Christians. It symbolized the tyranny of bishops over true churches and true Christians. A number of legal thinkers also argued against the legality of the High Commission, asserting that Parliament had never empowered it to imprison defendants and that the ex officio oath trampled on the traditional English liberties enshrined in Magna Carta. In the presence of Archbishop Matthew, the court arraigned Neville as one of the sects of Barrowists or Brownists. Neville refused to take the oath and he enjoyed needling his interrogators. He would answer, without an oath, questions from the other commissioners, but he refused to talk with Matthew at all. protesting very presumptuously and insolently in the presence of God against his authority, and as he termed it, his anti-Christian hierarchy. The Archbishop remanded him to the prison at York Castle. Neville was probably fortunate that his words did not cost him more dearly. The Archbishop's pursuivant next pursued Brewster, who twice failed to appear in court as required. Each time he incurred a fine of £20. Thomas and Joan Helwys also felt the Archbishop's legal pincers. In March 1608, Joan Helwys and two men were arrested, refused to take the oath, and join Neville in York Castle. Joan was released only to be reported in April, along with her husband, for having skipped church and communion for half a year. The crackdown showed no sign of abating. Brewster was not wealthy enough to pay a £20 fine every few months. As Bradford stated, they could not long continue in any peaceable condition. It was time for a second attempt to flee England. It was Mr. Thomas Helwys, John Robinson wrote a few years later, who, above all, furthered this passage, "If any brought oars, he brought sails." Robinson spoke metaphorically, but Helwys actually did bring oars and sails. This time, the departure point was a secluded location on the south bank of the Humber estuary. Helwys hired a keel, a flat-bottom barge with a sail. He told its master, Henry Spencer, that he needed to transport some goods belonging to his wealthy uncle, Sir Gervase Helwys. If Spencer didn't know it from the start, he soon figured out that his cargo would consist of men, women, and children. Helwys had him sail the keel up the River Trent to Gainsborough, where 15 individuals, mostly women and children, climbed aboard. The keel made other stops and soon carried around 80 persons. Spencer then steered his vessel back toward Hull, where the muddy and shallow Humber collides with tidal waters that rush in from the North Sea. The group spent the night of May 11th and the next morning huddled in a sheepcote near the small harbor of Stallingborough, where a stream emptied into the Humber. The marshy shoreline, with its many quiet inlets, was a good place to hide. Other men and women, including Thomas and Joan Helwys, traveled by land to join the group at Stallingborough. In the mid-afternoon of May 12th, a Dutch boy arrived. The keel had become mired near the creek, so around 15 of the men clambered into a cockboat, and two oarsmen rowed them to the hoy. Before the rowboat could bring a second group, a party of armed men appeared in the hills. Sacramente, the Dutch captain swore. His crew pulled anchor and put out the sails. Having been desperate to leave, the men aboard the hoy now longed to return to their wives and children. "It drew tears from their eyes," wrote Bradford, "and anything they had they would have given to have been ashore again." Instead, they remained at sea for 2 weeks, blown to the coast of Norway and nearly sunk by a violent storm. Like the Apostle Paul aboard a ship bound for Rome, Bradford and his companions went days without seeing the sun, moon, or stars. In Bradford's account, the sailors gave up while the faithful men aboard the hoy pleaded with God to spare them. "Lord, thou canst save," they cried out as the seawater lashed their faces. Upon which the ship did not only recover, Bradford wrote, but shortly after, the violence of the storm began to abate. The God of early 17th century England was often fearsome. He punished the land with plagues. He unleashed mighty storms against the godly and ungodly. At the same time, Bradford believed that God listened to the cries of his faithful. He did not always end their afflictions, but when the storms relented, the separatists attributed it to God's mercy. Of those left behind at Stallingborough, some men fled, and the troops rounded up the women and children. Helwys refused to talk. Henry Spencer and his servant testified about what they had done, but they had nothing to say about the motivation behind the undertaking. The authorities let them go. The Helwyses ignored summonses from the High Commission that summer. Gervase Neville and his two fellow prisoners languished in York Castle for another year. The Privy Council then banished them. As individuals and families gathered the means, they found passage out of England. In the Low Countries, they restored kinship and congregational ties. Others from places such as Canterbury and Sandwich joined them. It was the first step in the transplantation of churches that would eventually reach across the Atlantic. Chapter 2. Leiden. The Dutch Republic was in the early years of what later generations would call its Golden Age. In the coming decades, a young nation would grow wealthy through textiles, trade, and banking, produce artists such as Rembrandt and Vermeer, and acquire an empire that stretched from Brazil and the Hudson River to present-day Indonesia. When the new wave of English separatists arrived, however, Dutch Protestants were still seeking to secure their independence. In 1609, half a century after the northern provinces of the Netherlands had revolted against Philip II, the Dutch Republic, or United Provinces, signed a 12-year truce with Spain. The 1579 Union of Utrecht, which had formed the United Provinces, declared that each individual enjoys freedom of religion and no one is persecuted or questioned about his religion. At the same time, the Republic maintained a single public church. Magistrates gave Reformed, Calvinist congregations the exclusive use of church buildings, paid their ministers' salaries, and exercised some oversight of church affairs. Consistories, comprised of a city's ministers and elders, meted out church discipline and magistrates enforced public morality. Obtaining and maintaining church membership hinged on an individual's acceptance of this system of discipline. Much to the consternation of the Calvinists, only a small minority of Dutch men and women actually belonged to the Reformed churches. In the early years of the Republic, there were as many Catholics as Calvinists, and there were sizable Lutheran, Mennonite, and Jewish minorities as well. Dutch Calvinists were deeply committed to their liberty, but like English Protestants, they disagreed about its meaning. All cherished liberty from idolatry and superstition, Catholicism in other words, and they stressed God's sovereignty in saving his elect. There were many fault lines, however. Reformed ministers and many other Calvinists expected government support but opposed government interference, especially when it came to the selection of church officers. At the same time, freethinkers and libertines favored open church membership without consistorial discipline. For them, liberty meant freedom from any sort of ecclesiastical control, be that the papacy or the consistory. Despite the Union of Utrecht's declaration of religious freedom, the situation for religious minorities and dissenters was uneven and uncertain. Most Dutch politicians and ministers defended liberty of conscience, but by that they meant private belief and practice, not public worship or dissent. Catholics thus could not hold processions and public celebrations, and many cities forbade the construction of non-Reformed church buildings and synagogues. Especially after the demise of Robert Harrison's congregation, Dutch Reformed leaders in Middelburg and Amsterdam made plain their disapproval of Brownism. Even Lutherans sometimes found their liberties under assault. In other places, by contrast, officials tacitly permitted religious minorities to gather for worship, which they sometimes did in large private homes and buildings that functioned as churches without advertising themselves as such. It was toleration by connivance. Dutch toleration was good enough for most English exiles, but it did not satisfy those separatists who became the Mayflower Pilgrims. For them, the Dutch Republic's liberty was both too fragile and too expansive. The Spanish might regain control of the northern Low Countries, or Dutch magistrates might restrict their liberties. In the meantime, they could worship according to their principles, but they feared that pluralism, libertinism, and licentiousness would corrode their church and lead their children astray. Leaving unwanted types of liberty behind, they decided to chart their own more perilous course. The Scrooby and Gainsborough separatists first took refuge in Amsterdam. James Howell, who visited the city a decade later as an agent for a London glassworks, marveled that a rapid and monstrous increase of commerce and navigation had turned the low-lying city into one of the greatest marts of Europe. Churches proliferated nearly as quickly as merchant houses. After lodging with a Brownist who lived near a Jewish synagogue, Howell joked that there's no place so disunited as the United Provinces. English separatists were disunity specialists. Even before all of the Scrooby and Gainsborough congregants reached Amsterdam, John Smith and the leaders of Francis Johnson's ancient church were at odds. Smith's initial complaint centered on the use of the Bible during worship. Like most Puritans, Smith objected to the Book of Common Prayer's liturgy. Unlike them, he also wanted to banish written texts from psalm singing and teaching. In neither of them, the Spirit is at liberty, he argued. The primitive Christians, Smith believed, prayed, taught, and sang merely out of their hearts, and in so doing allowed God's Spirit to move their affections. Adam in Eden had worshipped God this way, and so would Christians in heaven. Outside of worship, Smith and his followers used the Bible to edify themselves and to settle questions of doctrine. But when it was time to pray, sing, and preach, they shut the book. Any use of the Bible in worship was idolatry. The leaders of the ancient church found Smith's objections absurd. Most English Protestants cherished psalm singing. It was the one part of worship guaranteed to keep congregants awake, and it was precious to separatists who had discarded other liturgy. Henry Ainsworth, the ancient church's teacher, a second minister alongside Francis Johnson, was a skilled Hebraist whom William Bradford later praised as a man of a thousand. Ainsworth made his own translation of much of the Old Testament, including a metrical psalter set to a number of tunes. The separatists who settled Plymouth Colony brought copies of Ainsworth's psalter with them. There was a second point of contention as well. The ancient church vested disciplinary authority in its elders. Ainsworth defended the practice. If the multitude govern, he asked, then who shall be governed? Ainsworth argued that Christian liberty, which all have, is one thing. The reins of government, which some have, is another thing. Smith insisted that the people held these reins. Drawing on classical republican models of mixed government, he understood Christ alone as the church's king, the elders as an elected aristocracy, and the remaining members as a democracy or popular government. Smith insisted that the negative voice is in the body of the church, not in the elders. Otherwise, the people surrendered their liberty to the arbitrary rule of their officers. As English Protestants had rejected Rome, and as the separatists had withdrawn from the Church of England, Smith fled idolatry once more. Rather than joining his followers to Johnson's church, he formed a second English church in Amsterdam. Smith next concluded that only baptisms received through true churches were valid. Thus, he considered himself unbaptized despite his infant baptism in the Church of England. So, he baptized himself. Smith's critics mocked him as a C-Baptist or self-baptizer. Smith then baptized Thomas Helwys and his other followers. Smith regretted his self-baptism after becoming acquainted with an Amsterdam congregation of Mennonites, descendants of the 16th-century reformer Menno Simons. Other Protestants referred to the Mennonites and like-minded churches as Anabaptists, meaning those who rebaptize, because of their rejection of infant baptism. Smith concluded that because the Mennonites belonged to a true church, he should have asked them to baptize him. Smith died before his followers completed their process of uniting themselves with the Mennonites. For most English Protestants, these events confirmed their suspicion that separatism was a byway to Anabaptism. Thomas and Joan Helwys followed Smith in rejecting infant baptism, but they then returned to England instead of uniting with the Mennonites. In London, Thomas Helwys helped organize a church on Baptist principles. He also became a bold, if impolitic, defender of religious liberty, arguing in his A Short Declaration of the Mystery of Iniquity, 1612, that the king had no power to command men's consciences. Rulers should not punish heretics, Jews, Turks, or even Catholics. Men's religion to God is betwixt God and themselves, he wrote. On the inside cover of a copy of his book, Helwys inscribed an incendiary note addressed to King James. The king is a mortal man and not God, therefore hath no power over the immortal souls of his subjects. King James disagreed. Kings are not only God's lieutenants upon earth, he explained to Parliament, and sit upon God's throne, but even by God himself they are called gods. Helwys died in prison. Back in Amsterdam, the ancient church endured a schism. George Johnson, the pastor's brother, had complained for years about the haughty attitude and stylish, revealing fashions of his brother's wife, Thomasine. The church finally excommunicated George Johnson and the brother's father, who had made a futile attempt to reconcile them. Several congregants then accused Elder Daniel Studley of beating his wife, seducing his stepdaughter, and committing adultery with a married woman. The less colorful issue of church government also caused a rift. Francis Johnson favored greater authority for the church's elders than did Ainsworth. Eventually, Ainsworth's faction gained control of the ancient church's building, and Johnson took his followers to Emden in Friesland. Nottinghamshire separatist Richard Clifton went with Johnson as his assistant. The ancient church members who remained in Amsterdam chose Ainsworth as their pastor. Richard Clifton, John Smith, and Thomas Helwys. All three were key leaders in the development of separatism in and around Scrooby and Gainsborough, and now all three had gone separate ways. John Robinson went his own way as well. He requested permission to bring 100 men and women to Leiden, 25 miles to the southwest of Amsterdam. In a letter, Robinson informed Leiden's magistrates only that they were members of the Christian Reformed religion. Ralph Winwood, the English agent at The Hague, who recently had helped finalize the truce between Spain and the United Provinces, complained to Leiden city leaders. Why were they granting shelter to a group of sectarians that England's government considered seditious? In response, a city official told Winwood that he had not known that Robinson's congregants were Brownists, but that all honest and law-abiding individuals were welcome in Leiden. In the spring of 1609, Robinson and his flock moved to what William Bradford later described as a fair and beautiful city. In 1573 to 1574, Leiden had withstood two Spanish sieges. Half of the city's 12,000 residents perished, but Leiden itself recovered quickly. William of Orange established a university in Leiden for the purpose of training reformed ministers. The institution lent the city intellectual and political prominence. Protestant refugees from the still Spanish southern Netherlands flooded into Leiden. Flemish migrants in particular revived and remade the city's textile industry, and Leiden became Europe's foremost producer of new draperies, lighter types of woolen cloth such as serge. The growth was staggering. By 1620, Leiden's population stood at nearly 45,000. There are hundreds of references to the separatists in the Leiden archives, marriages, births, deaths, and property transactions. Such documents are terse, though. There are no diaries, no autobiographies, and precious few letters. Thus we know that a couple married, but nothing about their marriage. We know that dozens of men, women, and children worked in the textile industry, and we know that their labor was difficult, but we do not know how individuals experienced it. At least 11 of the English separatists worked as drapers who produced the finished cloth and had workers underneath them. More were weavers and wool combers, who typically worked at home, which meant that their wives and older children spun yarn and knitted alongside them. Everyone worked who could work. Sons were typically apprenticed around the age of 12, sometimes for terms as long as 12 years. William Bradford was around 20 years of age when he came to Leiden. Bradford at first worked for a French silk weaver. Then he sold his land in England and started his own enterprise weaving fustian, a cloth made from linen and wool. Although Bradford apparently encountered some setbacks and exhausted much of his inheritance, he soon had his own house. In 1613, he married Dorothy May, whose parents had lived in Amsterdam the past 5 years. She gave birth to a son a few years later. Robert Cushman, the Canterbury grocer, became a woolcomber in Leiden. He purchased a house in 1611, albeit a residence worth one-third that of the more prosperous Bradford. In 1616, Sarah Cushman died while giving birth to the couple's second child, who perished 2 weeks after its mother. The next summer, Cushman remarried to Mary Shingleton, the widow of a sandwich shoemaker. The task of earning a living in drastically changed circumstances consumed much of their time and energy, but the separatists could gather together without the fear of arrest or imprisonment. At least for most of the 1610s, the congregation met in or near John Robinson's home, a property in the shadows of Leiden's imposing Peterskerk. They chose their own officers, Robinson as pastor, William Brewster as ruling elder, assisting with everything except the sacraments, and Samuel Fuller and John Carver as deacons. Morning worship consisted of extemporaneous prayers by Robinson and Brewster, psalm singing, the reading of several chapters of Scripture, a preached rather than read sermon, the Lord's Supper, and a collection for the minister's salary and the poor. When families such as the Bradfords and Cushmans had children, John Robinson baptized them without the sign of the cross or the liturgy of the Book of Common Prayer. When necessary, Sunday services included the censure or excommunication of members who had failed to walk in the ways of God as required by the church covenant. Families then ate their dinner before returning for prophesying in the afternoon. In this context, to prophesy did not mean to make predictions about the future. Rather, prophesying was the spiritual gift of expositing Scripture's meaning. During these afternoon gatherings, select laypeople as well as church officers could speak. Ye men and brethren, instructed the New Testament, if ye have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. Acts chapter 13, verse 15. While some Puritans supported lay prophesying, others objected to this hallmark of separatist worship. Why would congregants want to listen to weavers or woolcombers? Robinson countered that the people's liberty included the exercise of prophecy. Teaching was not the sole privilege of ministers and lay elders. Robinson even defended the right of women to prophesy, at least under the unusual inspiration of the Spirit. That separatists debated this point among themselves suggests that some women claimed this gift. Despite their removal to Leiden, the separatists, and John Robinson in particular, remained engaged within the broader world of English Protestantism. In 1610, Robinson came to know William Ames, a renowned Puritan minister who had recently fled England. The two men respected each other's learning but disagreed about separation. At the time, Robinson's position was that true Christians could not have visible communion with individuals who remained within the Church of England. They could not pray together, for instance. As far as Ames was concerned, Robinson's stance was narrow and bitter. "Are you more holy than Christ?" an exasperated Ames asked. Robinson soon changed his mind. In 1614, he published a book in which he made a distinction between public church communion and private fellowship. He now allowed that regardless of church membership, Christians could meet privately and pray together, sing psalms together, and read the Bible together. Ames urged Robinson to discard public separation as well. Robinson would not go so far, but he soon allowed his congregants to hear sermons in Church of England parishes. The latter question arose whenever the separatists visited England. For most separatists, attendance at Church of England services was tantamount to apostasy. Protestants would not go near a Roman Catholic Mass. How could true Christians listen to sermons delivered in anti-Christian English churches? The ancient church in Amsterdam customarily excommunicated individuals who went to hear Church of England preaching. "Our liberty is to them as rat's bane, poison," Robert Cushman commented, "and their rigor as bad to us as the Spanish Inquisition." Even within the Leiden congregation, Robinson's stance remained controversial. Robinson softened his rhetoric as the years proceeded, but he never repented of his separation. "The Church of England," Robinson wrote, "was a false church because it made every man a member, will he, nil he, fit or unfit, as with iron bonds. Rather than a house of God, it was more like a common inn whose door stands wide open to all that pass by the highway." The separatists would not accept all women and men, but they also forced no one to join them. Robinson drew a stark contrast between the ecclesiastical tyranny of the Church of England and his congregation's liberty. Male church members, women by their sex are debarred from the use of authority in the church, elected their officers, admitted members, and excommunicated gross offenders. Robinson was quick to add that the church's government was mixed rather than democratic. Christ was their king, and they deferred to the leadership of their chosen officers. Still, Robinson conceded that their church state was, after a sort, popular and democratic. The people governed themselves and worshipped as the Bible instructed. They exercised their liberty. Critics of separatism, Robinson insisted, would change their minds if they could observe the heavenly harmony and comely order of his congregation. "Never people upon earth lived more lovingly together," wrote Edward Winslow, a printer's apprentice who moved from London to Leiden. Other English exiles joined them, as did some Dutch and Walloon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.